We are very much dedicated at TheWrap, not just to informing and enlightening the people of the entertainment industry, but also reaching out to the future leaders of the entertainment industry and helping them find the connections and the ideas and the path into the confusing maelstrom that is entertainment and media today. We decided to call this evening a digital symposium because that's probably where you guys all want to go work, is my guess. Before we get started, I just want to thank our sponsor, IMAX, who really have just been fantastic partners on this. They are extremely enthusiastic also about getting to know the next generation of leaders and talent in the entertainment industry and have generously opened their offices, which is a stone's throw from your campus, so that we could experience this amazing theater and also get to meet some of the leaders of their company. I'd also like to thank LMU and especially Dean Ulaki, who's here, for all of the enthusiasm and support in bringing their students to this event. So thank you very much. Without further ado, I also would like to thank, because I'm always remiss, thank the TheWrap staff who worked so hard to put this together. So thanks you guys so much. We are very pleased to welcome a very interesting panel of speakers tonight. Please welcome Sophia Dilley, the Vice President of Development and Production at Route One Entertainment. Tim Staples, the CEO of Shareability. Greg Foster, the CEO of IMAX Entertainment, and Rich Gelfond, a surprise, we didn't announce him, the CEO of IMAX Corporation. So please join us. I feel weird with my little headset here. If there's anybody who comes in, there is one seat here, and if anybody has an empty seat, raise your hand maybe. I don't know if there's any other last minute folks. There's a seat here. Please don't be shy. This is meant to be for you guys. Also, we're going to be giving away a couple of IMAX tickets for people, a random person who gets chosen who is tweeting at the hashtag CollegeWrapIMAX. So let me just read a little bit of a background of the really super interesting people we have on this panel. Sophia Dilley is the Vice President of Development and Production at Route One Entertainment. She grew up on film sets. Her father is an award-winning production designer, and she has unique insight into the creative and management side of the film. She started her career in 2007, where she worked for Peter Berg, the director on Hancock and Battleship. And in 2010, she joined the team at Route One and helped oversee A Walk in the Woods and Equals. In 2014, Sophia joined Not Impossible Labs as a producer and the Ebling Group as a producer and head of production, tasked with producing commercials and documentaries, illustrating the application of high-tech solutions to serious real-world problems. She has been shortlisted for the AICP Awards, won the South by Southwest Innovation Award for Connecting People, and accepted the South by Southwest Innovation 3DIY Interactive Award for Project Daniel, along with Mick Ebling and Elliot Kotick in 2015. And in May of 2015, she returned to Route One Entertainment, where she now focuses on film, TV, and digital opportunities. And since her return, she has co-produced Tallulah, Colossal, and Landline, which was just at Sundance and got bought, congratulations, and oversees a diverse slate of upcoming projects. She has two bachelor's degrees from Loyola Marymount University.
Yeah.
One in film production and another in political science, and she has a master's specializing in international marketing and film from BU. Next, we have Tim Staple. Welcome, Sophia.
Thank you.
I'm reading fast because I don't want to spend the whole bio.
This one would be a lot shorter.
Yeah, his is shorter.
Tim, we
just dragged in from the street, basically.
Yeah.
No, he's the CEO of Shareability. He's the co-founder and CEO, working with global brands, studios, and digital influencers to create and distribute content that people love to share. He's been part of some of the biggest viral successes. Shareability co-founded an ROC, an audio technology company, in partnership with football superstar Cristiano Ronaldo. Before Shareability, Tim founded Converge, a new media promotional firm that created brand social campaigns with celebrities including Rihanna, Victoria Beckham, Courtney Cox, 50 Cent, and others. And before that, he was managing director of integration for Omnicom's marketing arm. Welcome, Tim.
Thank you.
Greg Foster, my good friend, is the CEO of IMAX Entertainment and the Senior Executive Vice President of IMAX Corporation. He was appointed a director of the company on October 19th, 2016. Congratulations, Greg. He joined the company in March 2001 as the President of Filmed Entertainment and was appointed Senior EVP in 2013. Before joining IMAX, Greg was the EVP of Production at MGM, United Artists. Before that, he held other senior positions, including SVP of Motion Picture Marketing Research during his 15 years at MGM. And in 1999, Greg founded U-Mogul, a financial services company, where he was chairman, co-founder, and president. Our surprise addition, welcome Greg. Or welcome, thank you for having us. Rich Gelfond is our last minute surprise addition. Woohoo, they were so lucky to have him. He's the CEO of IMAX Corporation, one of the world's leading entertainment technology companies. Under Rich's leadership, IMAX has evolved from a niche purveyor of nature and science documentaries to a movie force in Hollywood as a high-tech exhibitor and a creative partner in the movie-making process. IMAX now has more than 1,145 theaters in 70 countries, including 264 in China, which I imagine if we didn't update that number before today is probably higher than that today than it was yesterday, and has presented some of 2016's top movies, including Deadpool, Captain America, Civil War, and Jungle Book, and its upcoming slate includes Doctor Strange, Fantastic Beasts, Where to Find Them, and this is needs to be updated because it says Rogue One, a Star Wars story. This is last week's, last year's bio. IMAX has a major presence in China, where they entered 15 years ago, just as that country's entertainment, film, and exhibition industry was developing. So it has become a key part of that country's movie-going culture. Just because we're checking, Rich holds a BA from Stony Brook and a law degree from Northwestern University. So welcome all of you guys. Thank you. I don't know if did I check, Rich, where's your degree from? What's your degree?
Georgetown.
Georgetown, and what's your degree in?
Bachelor's of Science and Business Administration.
Okay, you've got to talk into El microphone.
Bachelor's of Science and Business Administration, sorry.
Bachelor of Science and Business Administration. And Tim, you keep yours off your bio, so I'm suspicious.
Yeah, I didn't go to school.
Did you not go to school?
No, I did. Yeah.
Oh, you did.
I went to the University of Missouri through the journalism school in advertising.
No way.
Yeah.
That's cool.
Yeah, I wanted to be a journalist until my dream was broken, Sharon.
Well, yeah, exactly, yeah. Exactly. Well, yeah. We can talk about that some other time. Yeah. There's no journalism people in the room, right? These are all film people. Okay, well. So what's so amazing is that we have people across the spectrum of the business side of the business, the creative side of the business, the new media side of the business, and sort of more of the establishment, which IMAX is really part of the establishment. I'm wondering, I'll start with you, Sophia. I mean, did you kind of go to school, get your degree, and sort of think, I am going to... Like, I want to be in production, and I know exactly how to get there? Or did you sort of end up there, you know, when you were a student thinking, I don't know, really know what I want to do, and you fell into a job, and that led you where you're at?
Well, originally I wanted to be a musician, so that work out. And I ended up falling into film because I love telling stories, and I think it's the best medium to communicate, you know, what you want to say to the world and mm-hmm. to help change things in the world. And so I did, I mean, my whole start was interning. That's where it all began. I didn't really know where it was going to take me. I knew I wanted to be in it. I knew, you know, ultimately I wanted to produce and direct. And I sort of just said, that's my direction and go.
Mm-hmm. So what was your first job?
I worked as a props PA on Hancock. And then I ended up, that's how I met Pete Berg, and he sort of took me under his wing and was like, you can be my intern. And I was like, awesome. And I would bring him coffee every day. And it was, you know, amazing that he let me shadow him and watch him for a couple of years. And I eventually became a second assistant for him. And mm-hmm. that's where I started.
Mm-hmm. So. Tim, I mean, you started Shareability. I mean, you wanted to be an entrepreneur when you sort of, you knew that, or did you fall into it? I kind of fell into it, honestly.
I started as a writer. Like, I went through journalism school, and then I wanted to be in advertising. That was back when advertising still had, like, some shred of glimmer to it back in the 90s. Mm-hmm. But when I got my first job, I started working at a sports agency that represented athletes, and they brought me in as a copywriter, so to write ads and all that. And what I figured out really quickly is that the writers are in the back room. And you can be really talented, but you're in the back room. Mm. And I wanted to be part of the action. You know, so like having creative talent is great, but if you can't sell that talent, you're in, literally in the back room. So for me, the big lesson early on was like learn how to sell yourself and learn how to present so you can get in the front room. You can be one of the one doing the deals. And then if you also are the one, the creative behind the deal, that's great too. But that was kind of the first lesson I learned coming out.
Mm-hmm. And Greg, you grew up in the entertainment business, right? You grew up going to the Oscars. You grew up on sets.
I grew up more on sets, not as she is going to the Oscars. My dad, who's still alive, but he's elderly, was actually a very, I think it's fair to say, important and prolific producer. Mm-hmm. And so the deal with my family was if my dad was gone for more than 2 weeks, we all went. So since six years old, I grew up half the time in L.A. and half the time all over the world on some pretty incredible movies, on the sets of movies like McCabe and Mrs. Miller, The Getaway, lots of Steve McQueen movies, The Drowning Pool with Paul Newman and Joanne Woodward, a lot of Steve McQueen movies, Cave Band with Ringo Starr in Mexico City.
You know which Steve McQueen, right, I hope.
Not 12 Years a Slave, Steve McQueen,
the actor, the original Steve McQueen.
So I'm the beneficiary of osmosis. That's how I got my first job. But it worked.
Yeah, it did work. Did you ever think you wanted to do anything other
no,
than
No, I didn't. Yeah. And by the way, my older brother, Gary, is a very successful producer from the same thing. He produced the score in Tin Cup and Sleepless in Seattle. Mm-hmm. And so I never shy away from talking about the fact that our dad ushered us into the business and encouraged it, and we found a love and passion for it, and I still have it today. Mm-hmm. But some people think that that's can be a bad thing if you're born into it, and I think it's about the luckiest thing that ever happened.
Well, it also sounds like your dad really looked out for you because, you know, you went with him. And so a lot of, I think, Hollywood families, they end up broken up because the family doesn't see one of the parents who's on sets or whatever. So
yeah, I mean, it's not always perfect, but it worked.
Yeah, yeah. Rich, how did you sort of fall? You come out of finance, you come out of mergers and acquisitions. How did you find your way into media and ultimately into, you know, running a big tech tech and creative company?
So I was a serial entrepreneur my whole life. When I was in high school, I didn't really go to class very much. I started a newspaper about New York sports that was sold at Madison Square Garden and every newsstand. I sold all the ads walking up and down Madison Avenue.
Did you grow up, in New York City?
In New York suburbs, actually. Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I just, again, I went to graduate school and I tried to, the coal industry was on strike and I figured out how to get coal and ship it to power plants. By going to the library in Chicago when I was at Northwestern, just cold calling coal companies, and I got an option on 1 million tons of coal. So I was always bitten by...
You were a student and you did this?
Yeah, with a professor who put up the money to back me. He's the guy actually who produced Grease originally. He found Grease. The guy got...
What's his
name? Tony D'Amato. He's still alive. But I started a chain of dry cleaning stores and sold it to Colgate Palmolive. So I was just kind of always into starting things and doing things. And then I tried to earn a living in an honest way. I was an investment banker. I was a lawyer. My kids hated it. They never knew what I did. They couldn't talk about it. So it's actually, take a second more, but it's interesting. So Washington's birthday weekend, it wasn't called President's Day then, we went to the Smithsonian and we saw something called an IMAX theater. And I'd never been to one, but I said, gee, that's really cool. Let's go check it out and see.
Were they showing like planets?
They were showing To Fly.
To Fly, I saw that.
We sat in the front row because it was so crowded in the theater. And then a day later, I got a book saying IMAX was for sale. And it was it seemed like some cosmic force intervening in my life, because why would that happen? So took a look at the company with my partner at that time, and we raised the money. And the founders asked why we're interested. And I said one of the reasons was my kids had no idea what I did and they couldn't enjoy it. And I thought it'd be something really cool to do and hang like Greg with his family as a way to do something way more interesting. So we bought the company. And when we bought it, I think there were 65 theaters in the world. The company bled money. It didn't just lose money. It bled money.
Wow.
And so my favorite statistic is, when Greg and I, years ago, we used to have you know, maybe in 7 years ago, 150 theaters, and we had 8 films a year. So that's like 600 or 700 transactions. And now we have 1,200 theaters and 50 films a year. So we have 60,000 transactions. Mm. So although I bought it, what we created and the IMAX employees created is something totally different than
what
we
bought. So when you bought IMAX, how many employees were there?
I don't know, but in equity, we put up $18 million to buy the company. And now there are two public companies, one here and one in China, and they're each worth $2.5 billion in equity. So it was pretty good.
Amazing. What year was that?
1994.
That's an amazing.
So guys, the best way to get a job in the industry is to buy the company.
Or sell coal.
Yeah. Or dry cleaning.
I think that's a really good point. Is like one of the things that sort of propelled us to undertake the series. Is that I think it is confusing. I mean, I have college age kids, and I think. It is. You guys can validate or not validate, but it feels like it's really, when you come out of school, there's just so many different ways, options of routes to go in, and the traditional routes are sort of under pressure, and so what everyone's just to go work at Google, but if you're a creative, like, honestly, but that's not feasible. Do you think that what you did 20 years ago, was it 30, 20 years ago, could you do today?
I do.
Could be done today.
As a matter of fact, I think the opportunities are even more than they were then, because I think everyone here, partly because of changes in the industry and more platforms and mobile platforms and changes in distribution and movements to digital, I think it's much less capital to get into the entertainment business than it used to be. And I think you and three of your friends could start a company, and you know, which is what Larry and Sergey did at Google, and what Zuckerberg did at Facebook. So, I think you know, it's kind of a bifurcated world. You have these big companies, which is maybe harder to break into. But I think anyone who has an iPhone and a dream—I hate to sound like a commercial—an iPhone and a dream, you know, you can go out and do your own thing.
Well, but don't you guys, as leaders of IMAX, don't you want those young people who have a dream and an iPhone? Isn't that who you want innovating in your company?
So yes, but we're a bit of a different culture. In our culture, we're, first of all, we're a company, so it's a little bit different than going out and making a movie. But one of the things for our company that's really worked, and I think particularly, by the way, your school is an example of it, is we really take our summer internship program seriously. We have anywhere between 15 and 20 interns, and I would say, by the way, many of whom are in this room who now work at IMAX. Mm-hmm. So I would say,
in what category? Like, are you looking, do you have engineers? Is it marketing?
All
is
of it. All of it. We have, it. I would say, 15% of IMAX in Playa Vista started as summer interns. By the way, one of them is Ashley Imrani, who works with you guys, who's interned for us, and I'm sure will eventually work for us. Mm-hmm. So it's a, and she was an amazing intern last summer.
You just got a job. Yeah.
it's a really great program, and I think it's very important to kind of dig into a place. And again, I go back to what I was saying to someone earlier today. I don't remember if it was here or when I did the interview for you guys. But if you just say, I want to be in the movie business, give me a job, I don't really care, you'll never get hired. You have to tell someone, my entire life, it's a very self-important business. I'm not saying that's good or bad, it just is. And if you tell someone, my entire life, all I've wanted to do is work at whatever company you're interviewing, you're going to have a pretty decent chance of getting it if you just keep
fill in the blank.
If you just keep pestering them. Mm-hmm. And once you get in the door, I have college kids, as you know, I would never have my kids intern somewhere where they hadn't done due diligence and determined that company tends to eventually hire their interns. Mm-hmm. And that's something you can find out. Mm-hmm. So there's little kind of tricks to the trade. Mm-hmm. But I think internships are very, very important, and it's certainly important to us.
Tim, I would ask you, as an entrepreneur who's started a company, how old is Shareability now?
3 years.
3 years old.
Yeah.
Okay, so if you are coming out of college right now, and I'm going to talk to people more on the business side, and we can talk about the creative side of a career in a second, but I think that there is pressure on young people to feel like you need to start your own company.
Right.
Right. Like you need to be the next Mark Zuckerberg. You need to be the next Evan Spiegel. You need to, you know. So how do you evaluate that choice of whether really you should go out and get experience in a lot of basic business skills that you don't have when you're 22 and coming out of school, or you should take the leap and, you know, like Evan, you'll figure it out. Or like Mark Zuckerberg, you'll drop out of Harvard and, you know.
It's a good question. Show of hands, who in here wants to start their own company? Decent amount.
Higher. I can't see. Okay, yeah. So I'd say maybe 20% of people.
20%? Yeah, I think what's happened, Sharon, is that, like, when I was coming up in the 90s, you know, you paid your dues in your 20s. It was all about paying your dues and then moving on in your 30s. And then I think what's happened is there's been a complete overcorrection the other way, where now anyone can start a company at any age, 22, 24, and it can be the next unicorn, right? And so there's been kind of this false hope, and now there's so many people out there trying to do that with very little experience.
And venture money to fund them, too.
Right, and all the venture funds have been, you know, been fueling the problem in a lot of ways. They're funding a lot of entrepreneurs, and they don't care if 19 out of 20 fail, as long as one hits and they get their money back. And so the way I'm looking at it is you almost counter-program it. I feel like there's a big opportunity now to just really put your head down in your 20s. When everybody's kind of looking at the stars, you can stay really head down. And like to me, your 20s is all about exposure. Like get exposure to the type of people you want to be around, the things you want to learn, and the people you want to meet. And if you can get your 20s right and you can do all those things, then you're set up to crush your 30s. Because I think like the 20s is the time when you experiment, you figure out what you like, you learn a lot, and hopefully you meet the people that are going to propel your career past then. And then when you hit 30, now you hit the throttle and you go do what you want to do, but you have a lot more experience, you have a lot more relationships, you got some life, you know, kind of advice to go by, and I think you're going to be a lot more successful. And I think you can use that to your advantage to a lot of people that are just running out, like, I'm going to go start my own company, and they're going to fail and fall off, and you'll be so much better off at 35 than they will.
Starting a company at 35?
Yeah, if you use your 20s to get strong and your 30s to propel, whether that's 30 or 35 or 39, I just think it's a better strategy. And don't
Do you think that it's going to be, because it feels like anyone can start a company today.
Yeah.
By the way, actually, anyone can start a company today, right? I mean, you know, legal Zoom? You know, you call them up, you pay $100, you can get the paperwork and sign, and you're done.
Robert Shapiro.
Yeah. Thank you, Bob Shapiro. So, but maybe that's because people feel like they need to seize the moment. Like right now, you know, it's totally flat. The barrier to entry is so flat right now. And maybe if I wait 10 years, it won't be. You know what I mean?
Yeah. But at the same time, there's only so many people that can succeed in that kind of world. So like the odds are just stacked against you. And that's the story you don't get told. One of the things I've been thinking a lot about recently is there's all these really, you know, big entrepreneurs with big personalities. What they need is a really strong number two person.
Yes.
And like there's a really important role to be had of just being like this rock solid, make it happen, operational person. And I think if people had that and embraced that and like looked for their partner that may be more a number one, there's a lot of room in the number two space. You know, so I just think there's a lot of ways to think about it. But I also know that you guys are going into a tough place right now. Like it's a different place. It's a lot scarier than it's been. It feels like there's more opportunity on one hand, but less on the other. And like it's like the swirling kind of confusion and doubt, and so I you know I sympathize because I know it's not easy, but I feel like if you can just really get a lot of value out of your 20s and not worry about where it takes you and not overthink it, you'll be in a really good spot as you kind of come into your own in your 30s, and that's when you can really start making it happen. At least that's what I think about.
And so don't think at all about the fact that Snapchat had its IPO today for, you know.
Right.
Filed for its first for its IPO.
Don't look at the shiny red ball, Sharon.
Don't look at it.
No, well, it can be destructive because, listen, I mean, that's a one in a gazillion. I mean, truly. I mean, like, how many people have tried to do that and failed? And you don't hear those stories, right?
Well, I think Venice today and Playa Vista and Santa Monica is just full of those stories.
Yeah. And the thing they don't tell you is how much, you know, you guys all know this, is like how much entrepreneurship can take out of you personally. Like it can be a little soul crushing because you keep hitting this wall. There's no one there. It's very lonely. So you got to be ready for it. And if you're not mature enough to handle it or if you're not ready for it, it can really beat you down, which can have kind of long lasting effects on where you go from there. At least that's been my experience. Mm-hmm. It's not a fun, easy trip most days. So.
Mm-hmm. So you got to really believe in what you're doing.
You got to want it, yeah.
So Sophia, for people in this room who want to go into the creative side of filmmaking, and I think, you know, you have all these film schools, not everybody can be a director, and it's harder than ever to be a producer, and congratulations to you for working on such high quality films. It can't be easy to do that. I don't even know.
No, it's not easy. Well, okay, I think that one of the biggest things to learn as an intern, right, is, which is the first point you're going to be entering any company, is to kind of learn how to take initiative in the right way. And it's being able to kind of understand the needs of where of the company you're at, and then also be able to use, I mean, you're all getting educated at college, you're going to be smart, you're going to have a perspective that matters. One of the things that I did when I first interned at Route One, because I had interned there for 2 days before I got hired to go work as an assistant for Pete Berg.
Wow.
Was I read
did
a little script by a man named Damien Chazelle, whose movie you're going to see tonight. And I went in and was like, this script is amazing. And you guys really need to buy this. Like, and I'd been there for 2 days. And I was like, I'm telling you this, I'm putting everything on the line for you. Like, this is, I would make this movie. And it's one of his thriller scripts and hasn't been made yet, but it will. It's in process right now. But I remember being like, I'm sure a lot of kids come in and read something and maybe don't say anything or don't quite know how to articulate that. And so it's figuring out how to actually match what your creative aspirations are with the right company. I think the point that was made earlier about finding a company that fits for what you're looking for is really critical. It's like knowing, you know, doing the research, figuring out, okay, this company is actually going to hire its interns or has a good history of interns moving on to do amazing things. Like if you can get an internship for Scott Rudin, go ahead and do it.
I'm going to interrupt for just 1 second because I know this also because, I have a number of college age or just out of college kids. Internships are not as easy as they used to be because a lot of companies in Hollywood have stopped providing internships because of the lawsuits that happen. Has anyone here experienced that problem? That like you, I know that you know, from my own kids that they've applied for internships. They're willing to work for free. The company wants them, and then like legal shuts it down, saying, "Oh no, if you can't get school credit." And so what was happening, at least in the instance that I know in my own case, and I know a couple other kids, they had to pay for the credit. It's like, well, you have to not only you basically have to pay for the internship. Not only do you not get paid. So a lot of people can't afford to do that. And I'm on principle, I'm opposed to that because I think that's really not okay. But is this a familiar thing anybody know?
It was familiar for me too. I had the same experience.
Okay.
But one of the loopholes I found was actually going to a community college and finding the cheapest internship class I could and then paying for it that way. Because it is true. I mean, at LMU, it's like $4,000 for this internship class, which is not feasible if you're going to intern. I interned for 2.5 years in college, and that wouldn't have worked within my budget. I'm certainly paying for it now. So I think the key is being kind of, you have to figure out the way around that. Now, I don't know if that's still even a possibility. I think it is a real issue based on the lawsuits, and it was a lot more lenient, you know, years ago.
Do you think, I mean, being a producer today is not what it was, say, 10 years ago, right, when there used to be producers who had companies that were funded by the movie studios, they'd be on the lot. Those really don't exist anymore. So how has that affected your ability to kind of find a stable path as a producer?
Well, I'm very fortunate to have worked at an independent company that had a lot of money behind it to make independent films, which is very hard to find. And I'm thankful every day because I do think that as a producer, if you're pursuing just being an on-the-ground indie producer, it is a grind. I mean, it's people, you have to be able to find the right material that people are going to read when you don't have a company backing you. And I have friends who are very successful at this, but it takes, I really think there's something to be said about working in your 20s and putting your head down at the right company and figuring out, okay, I'm going to make 100 friends each year who hopefully 5 of those people pay off in the long run for when you can get going and you actually have the experience behind you to support your creative pursuit. I really think that's part of, you just have to be willing to do the work, and it's a lot of work.
Well, one of the other amazing things when you get to go to school like LMU is it's also the people who are sitting next to you or your roommates or, you know, people you worked on a project, those are going to be your colleagues and your friends and your partners your whole life as you, over the next 20, 30 years. And that's one of the huge benefits of being in a school like LMU, I think. And I hear those stories over and over, and you meet them. The Oscar conversation, yeah, we were roommates at Boston, or we were roommates, you know, wherever. So those are very, very real things. The people who you meet now, the trust, the connections that you make are going to be.
Look at La La Land.
Yeah, Damien's, that's right, Justin and yeah, Justin Damien.
He went to school with those guys.
We're at Harvard together, yeah. So I found out because I asked Damien, Justin dropped out, the composer. And I don't know about Damien if he did or not. But yeah. Before we open up to questions, I'd love to hear from each of you. Like, if you had to give one piece of advice to the people here, students here, who would like to be able to have a career in the business, what would you say?
Persistence. That would be it for sure. Because especially in the entertainment industry, it's a game of numbers. You know, whether you're a director, a producer, or your talent, and you have to learn to take no so many times. And it could be debilitating, or it can be inspiring. And it's a really hard thing. No one in this room was born, at least on that side, but a guy named Richard Nixon, who was president of the United States and has a very bad reputation, by the way. But he once said the difference between winning and losing is how you handle losses. And I think that's just so true in your career at every level. So I think it's tough. You gotta just knock on tons of doors. You gotta send out tons of resumes. And you know, if you quit, no one's gonna pick you up. You have to pick yourself up. So that would be my thing, persistence.
Find one thing that you're better at doing than most other people who are applying for that job. Have a skill and play on that skill and promote that skill and work really, really hard at differentiating yourself from others.
Well, you just took mine. what I always say is just be awesome at one thing. I think that everybody tries to be really well-rounded, and that's a good thing. But like you said, if you can crush one thing, for us as a business, you know, we were in digital content doing all this stuff, and we decided we were going to be the best at YouTube. We were going to be better than anyone else at creating these big hits for YouTube. And that's exactly what we did, and that's when our careers took off. And so I would say the same, find out what that is that you can become an expert in that no one else knows, and then go crush that, and you'll always be valuable.
These are all so good. I would say a combination of saying yes to every opportunity that comes your way, if you're not like set in a job already. Everything that's ever happened for me, I've like said yes to something. I was like, oh, do I really want to go to this event? Do I really want to go to this, you know, screening, whatever it is? And I've always met someone or something has come out of it that was helpful in my pursuit of what I've been going after. And it's like saying yes and networking. You know, meeting as many people as you can and establishing real relationships with them.